TechnologyOne is not a new Aussie tech company. It's been around for longer than most, but it's currently transforming itself into a SaaS business. The migration is of its customers to this cloud model is about 50% complete. And we as investors know that SaaS, and we've learned this morning, should lead to greater recurring revenue and higher margins. But is the move to the cloud, and importantly, moving existing customers to the cloud, all smooth sailing? Well, we're very pleased to welcome CEO Edward Chung to Tech Decoded. Edward, nice to see you there. I understand TechnologyOne has a goal of $500 million in ARR by 2026. So what are you obsessed with as CEO on a daily basis to get to that goal?
Well, it's important that we have that goal out there for two reasons. We do it, one, for our people and our staff and to anchor all of our actions to achieving that goal. We have a philosophy in TechOne, if we say it, we'll do it. So we've said it and we align all our strategies to it. The second reason we say it and why we're obsessed about it is for the investment community. In my experience, in my mind, there's sort of two types of companies out there. One that don't put out long-range guidance and strategies, and one that do. And if you don't do it, the market will probably make it up for you anyway and make a whole lot of assumptions. And we choose to put out a long-range guidance, such as $500 million worth of ARR by FY26. One for transparency, and two so that we can anchor all our conversations around that target. As we achieve our goals, we can explain what is going well in our business and what we're learning and what we need to pivot and what we need to change. And if we miss our goals, then we can anchor the conversations to what has not worked rather than having a conversation without anything to anchor it to. So it's a long-range ambitious target. We put it out there for everyone to see. It's very transparent in the investment community, but up and down our entire organization, we set all of our action plans and strategies to achieve them, and we've been achieving them. And that gives the market a lot of confidence in our execution ability, and it's why TechOne's been so successful over the last 35 years.
And transforming the business, as I referenced earlier, to a SaaS model. Yeah. I understand that TNE, TechnologyOne, I'm referring to the ticker code, of course, for the ASX, undertook some research into, I guess, the opportunities, you could call it, the economic opportunities that could come from a SaaS economy, so to speak. Why did you as a company undertake this research?
Yeah, so when we were talking to our customers, they were telling us a number of things. They were validating that moving to SaaS allowed them to innovate faster. You know, we took care of all the technology. They're always on the latest release, latest tech, highest level security. But they also told us that they saved 30%+ on their total cost of ownership of IT. And rather than us, you know, saying that to our future prospects and other customers, we hired Insight Economics and IBRS to do some research. And that research was very high fidelity, and it was looking at the entire markets we serve, local government, higher education, government, asset intensive industries, and health and community services. And we asked the question, if every organization in those sectors moved to software as a service, how much would they save? And when they save that money, how much would that mean to the economy? How much more could they invest in providing community services, you know, educators, assets, infrastructure for us, more nurses in aged care? And the number was outstanding. It was huge. It was honestly too big to ignore. We didn't believe it at first, so we sent them back to do a few more interviews and to test the numbers. And the number will blow your socks. It was $224 billion saved over the next 10 years by moving to software as a service. And as I said, you know, that will build lots of bridges and roads and hire a whole lot more nurses and put it where the money should be spent, you know.
So where are the most, I guess, the most economic benefits potentially being derived from this transition to SaaS?
Well, it's the direct money saved in the organization, and it's where that investment can be made. It shouldn't be made in back office systems. If you're running a local government, it should be providing the community services. You know, if you're running universities, it should be more university positions or more professors, more educators, you know, to inspire the next generation. And so when you look at that $224 billion, it was spread fairly equally amongst those sectors I called out. And it's just a huge opportunity for Australia to accelerate faster to software as a service and get those economic benefits. Another way to put it is it's 1.3% of GDP. And if you compared it to, you know, a massive infrastructure program like Olympic Dam, it's six times the size of that. So it's just, it's quite mind-boggling.
Mm-hmm. And do you think that we're potentially falling behind here in Australia in terms of the adoption of SaaS in government, in industry? And, you know, no doubt that's where a lot of the opportunity lies for TechnologyOne.
I think there's a bucket load of opportunity, if I can put it that way. You know, we should accelerate. Governments should move faster. They should move to a SaaS-first policy.
Now, let's talk about the company. For TechnologyOne, where do you see the real sources of this this increase in annualized recurring revenue coming from?
Yeah. If you think about what we do, we provide enterprise solutions that are very broad and very deep for the markets we serve. And if I focus in on local government and higher education, we've got 15 products. Each product has 20 to 30 modules. So that's about 350 modules that we can provide to a local government or a higher education institution to streamline their business, to make life easy for them. So there's a lot of mission critical, you know, sticky systems that runs a higher education or local government organization. And then what we do is we break that down in our own platforms for growth, targeting new logos, new customers we don't have, targeting what we call product take-up or product penetration, and that's providing more and more of our products to existing customers. We have geographical expansion. We have broke even in the UK a couple of years ago, and it's really starting to accelerate. When we get the UK really firing, perhaps the US is on the radar. And, of course, we continue to build or acquire new products or new modules. So there's, we call them platforms of growth, and there's plenty of platforms of growth in the TechnologyOne strategies, and it's partly why we continue to have that very consistent, you know, growth in our business over the last 35 years.
And when you think about, or when investors are thinking about annual recurring revenue, how should they put that in context with the expansion of margins or the impact that that will have on margins?
Yeah, it's a good question. As we've moved almost our entire customer base to software as a service, we're getting extreme economies of scale. We run multi-tenanted SaaS with one single global code line for all sectors that we serve. So we serve, you know, six sectors, 1,200 customers, whether you're a hospital, a local government, a university, a government department, it's all done in our single global code line. Our magic is that it's highly configurable, so it looks customized to you, and it, therefore it's really efficient. So we make one code line change for a new feature, a new function, a new product, or a bug fix, and all customers get it immediately. So there's massive, massive economies of scale. I think our profit before tax margin last year was 31%. We can see a clear path to 35% in the next few years. And, you know, in the TechOne way, when we get to 35, we'll just set the next target at 40%. So significant margin expansion through the, you know, significant economies of scale of SaaS.
Your target, man. I like it. All right. You mentioned the UK business in there. Is that business and the potential scale there really becoming more clear?
Yeah, it really is. I think we're focused on two vertical markets in the UK, local government and higher education. And when we simply look at those two markets, they're at least three times the size, maybe even five times the size of the Australian market. They're also, we're very strong in Australia, New Zealand, and this side of the world, if you like, in those two markets. And we've taken our products and solutions there and are doing very well in local government and higher education. So the opportunity is massive, and it's really starting to accelerate. As I said, we became break even a couple of years ago. We've hired a whole team there. If I had this conversation with you a few years ago, we would have had 35 staff. Probably most of them were expats. Fast forward to now, we've got about 70 staff. There would only be probably one expat left in the UK. We recently acquired Scientia, which is very strong globally in higher education with timetabling and scheduling. Huge customer list, if you like. very proud customers, you know, the Russell Group or Sandstones, we'd call them here in Australia, 70 staff locally. So we've doubled the scale of the UK business, added at least 100 university logos, which we didn't have. Now we can sell the rest of our enterprise suite into student management, financials, everything else. So the opportunity is massive. It is a significant platform for growth for TechOne going forward.
Now, you also drip-fed us just a bit about the United States because, I mean, the addressable market there, we all know it's massive. So what needs to happen? What needs to be put in place for you to move into that market in a significant way?
Yeah, we've got a lot of opportunity still in APAC, massive opportunity. So even though we have a lot of logos, broad spread of logos, high penetration from that point of view in local government and higher education, we've got low product penetration, so there's significant runway for growth in APAC. And we've done our own calculations, and in any single vertical market in APAC, we'd only have 15% penetration when you count all the products that, and modules that customers could take from us. And as I said, the UK is massive, so there's a lot of opportunity there. So to answer your question, we need to execute and really scale and drive faster growth in the UK. We've learned a lot of lessons entering a new region. It will feed us and our growth will be tremendous just focusing on APAC in the UK. And we'll start our research in the US in the coming years. But it takes a long time to take a complex ERP so broad and so deep into a new market and to do it well. It's long range planning, if I can put it that way, but something that we are interested in doing after we get UK firing on all four cylinders.
So that's one ambition that doesn't yet have a specific target attached to it. Now, look, there's no denying that the macro environment has changed greatly over the past couple of years. We know why. Inflation is a big concern. And when you're talking about expansion in APAC and Europe, I think about inflation. We can talk about it in many different ways, shapes, or forms, but how about price inflation in very general terms when you're talking about getting these highly skilled IT professionals on board?
Yeah. I think there's a couple of prongs to your question. In terms of how we engage with our customers, we've never increased our prices to our customers. It's been the same price for as long as I've been here, 15 years, and probably even longer. What we've done from the start, however, is included CPI in our contracts with our customers. But we don't rest on our laurels. We ensure that we continue to provide significant value to our customers every year. It's why we have 99%+ retention of our customers over the last 35 years, because that's significant value you provide our customers. So we've invested over $500 million of R&D in the last 10 years in a number of areas. We're probably the only ERP provider in the world that's rewritten their code not once, not twice, but four times over the last 35 years to keep our customers abreast of the latest tech. We've invested tens of millions of dollars in cybersecurity, and we have the highest level of cybersecurity certification, for example, IRAP protected of any ERP provider on the planet. And so we continue to show value to our customers, and so they've accepted CPI for the last 35 years and will. On the flip side, that gives us optionality and flexibility to do the right thing by our staff, which is continue to pay our staff well. But we say to our staff also that there are three prongs to what we do when it comes to you, our staff members. One is the purpose of our company. We are solving some of the most complex problems for local governments and higher education and government departments. So it's very meaningful work. Two is you join TechOne for a career. So we're focused, hugely focused on career plans for all of our staff to continue to grow with us. Three is we focus on their well-being, whether that's mental, physical, emotional, financial, all parts of their well-being. And four is our foundation. You know, we are very passionate about giving back to the communities we serve. We set an ambitious target on our foundation, and that is to lift 500,000 children and their families out of poverty by 2032. And so all of those things help us attract and retain our staff, and that might be a long-winded way of answering your question, but it's a complete package.
Okay. And just to be clear, because I know investors will be interested, it is written into the contracts that you can increase prices by CPI yearly.
Yeah, that's exactly right. Yeah.
Right. Look, the current macro environment, you're leading this company, you're the CEO. Does it make it more difficult when you consider all of, not just, you know, the forces at play in the economy, but the fact that tech as a whole has really been dragged down in terms of share price performance? I mean, no CEO, I keep saying this, likes to talk about share price performance. They all say that they don't watch it on a daily basis, but how much does that factor into your strategic decision-making?
To be honest, it factors 0% into the strategic decision-making. We focus on the things that we can control. We focus on growing ARR, delighting our customers, delivering the profit and the profit margin that we've delivered. You see our track record over the last 35 years. Share price factors nothing. And I heard your last interview, we don't watch it at all, and it doesn't change any of our decision making.
Okay. And so just in terms of modules, I know that you've got a lot of expansion into this SaaS universe. You've got penetration that you can look for opportunities and growth within the module. How about new products?
Yeah. So we've got an exciting new product range, or maybe next generation of product called DXP, which is Digital Experience Apps. As we all know, the world has moved to digital. It's been Uberized. It's been consumerized. And our enterprise software is extremely powerful and has been really focused on what I call the power user or the back office user. Those are people such as the accountants, you know, running the accounts, the payroll clerks, the student administration team that's admitting students, or the rating clerks in local governments. We've been very successful. And there's been, you know, in an organization, there's hundreds, maybe thousands of those staff. But in a local government, there are tens of thousands, even hundreds of thousands of you and I ratepayers in a local government organization. And in universities, there's tens to 50,000 of students in a university. And they've been untapped for us. So we're taking the enterprise from the back office to what I call the front office, or the end users, and providing digital experience apps for students or for ratepayers. It's very exciting. It's very new to us. It's a long-term strategy, but it'll open up a whole new user base and a whole new market for us, and will be another platform for growth for many, many years to come.
And how important is it to you to ensure that you're getting those growth plans and clarity around them, and in essence, educating the markets and you know, engaging like this with stakeholders and retail investors?
It's hugely important. I was talking to an investor a couple of months ago, and he was quite complimentary about how long-range planning approach that TechOne has. So, you know, we've got these ambitious targets today out to 500 mil by 2026, and we've outlined the different platforms for growth. Under the covers, we're working on another 4, 5, 6 additional platforms for growth, which will take us to the next ambitious target, and that might be $1 billion, you know, by early 30s, who knows, but that's what we're working on now. It's very important for the investment community. It's very important to align our staff to the goals that we're undertaking. And I just recommend that, you know, companies that are thinking about coming down the listing route to have that level of rigor and, you know, long-range planning, and it just helps with execution.
Well, Edward, we're just getting a little bit tight on time, but because you've done a lot of thinking about the broad SaaS landscape, and that's what a lot of our, you know, our viewers are interested in, you're taking this Aussie Tech global, but what policy changes, going back to your research, do you think need to happen, should happen, to prioritize investment in innovation here in Australia? What would make running your business, growing your business easier?
Yeah, look, I think government should move faster to adopt software as a service. By adopting software as a service, they would see and feel what it is. They'd get the benefits. They could invest more in, you know, the critical infrastructure to support Australia. It might also then shape their policy decisions as they learn more and more about it to support the local tech scene.
Got it. Listen, Edward, it was a good conversation. Thank you so much for joining us here on Tech Decoded.
Thanks for having me.